Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship on this last Sunday in February and second Sunday in the season of Lent. This morning we hear Jesus teach about what it means to receive and take up our cross. And so it is that you have been given this cross, which is your death, but is also your resurrection. And this is our great peace. So it is in the name of Christ that we worship this morning. And I say to you once again, welcome and good morning. You have perhaps seen posters. You've maybe wondered about our high school youth director. He's getting a little burly looking. Maybe he's given up trimming his beard for Lent. You might wonder about this. I just want to reassure you that this is all for a good cause, for the great Bethel Beard Off. Tyler and I are growing our beards out, and you are welcome to contribute money that will go toward our youth going to Houston this summer for the ELCA youth gathering. The deadline is March 10th. Whoever has the most money given in their name will be, well, stripped of their beard unceremoniously in between services on the Sunday following in March. I believe that's the 18th, 17th. And you're welcome to join in the fun of the great Bethel Beard Off. Speaking of Lent, we continue with our great Lenten series. It is most certainly true. Luther, Lent, and the Reformation on Wednesdays. And we encourage you to continue your worship life on Wednesday evenings as well. We have a few great things going along with this. Our Luther and Katie selfie station are up in the narthex, and we have flat Luther's out again, all to explore the great themes of the Reformation and what this actually has to do with our lives as Christians today, which is actually quite a bit. So come Wednesday nights and Wednesdays at noon for worship. March, as you may recall, is Minnesota Food Share Month. And typically, we have had great partnership in Minnesota Food Share Month as a congregation at Bethel. I believe we have a video ready to go to introduce to you what exactly we're doing this year.
Benvenuto, bellissimo, table for one.
Buonasera, you are our guest at Bethelios.
Oh, what a warm welcome. Why, thank you, but actually a table for 13,000 people.
Excuse? Did she say a table for 13,000 people?
Mamma mia, you must have some kind of limo coming with the rest of your people left.
Oh, no. I've come to visit Bethelios on behalf of 13,000 people.
Oh, phew! It would take us all day long to get 13,000 chairs at Bethelios. Oh.
I saw your face, Fernando, when she said 13,000 people. Your eyes as big as the meatballs as that we serve with the spaghetti.
You see, 13,000 people in Olmsted County are food insecure. And I heard that Bethelios wants to do something about it.
See, Bethelios is a very generous place.
Yes, and I have heard that throughout the month of March, you will be collecting pasta and sauce to donate to Channel One Food Bank. Pasta and sauce will help feed the hungry in Olmsted County.
Pasta and the sauce is our specialty here at Bethelios. At Bethelios, we will donate, well, mustard jelly. Oh, yes, very good. And we have a little bit of farfalle, and a little elbow macaroni, and a little more mustard jelly. We've got it all here at Bethelios.
Yeah.
You got any rigatoni, bub?
Oh, yeah, we got the rigatoni, you know, but out back, if you know what I mean.
And the sauces, too. Can't forget the sauce. It can be in jars, big jars, small jars. It could be from our favorite kitchens, like Prego, and a kitchen like Ragu. They're both Prego. Ragu!
These are great examples of pasta and sauce that you can bring throughout March Minnesota Food Share Month. And did you know that 3,400 households visit the food bank every month in Olmsted County? So this will really help to stock their shelves. But remember, Donations of sauce must be in plastic containers, not the glass, or you could lose your precious salsa.
Si, plastic es more fantástico.
If Bethelios is really committed to making a difference, we could collect a lot of pasta and a lot of salsa.
That's right, and I challenge Bethelios to collect $5,000 in donations and 1,500 pounds of pasta and sauce.
Excelente. No problemo.
Could be a problemo. Unless you are generous, Bethelios.
Wonderful. I will return in April to see if you have reached your goal.
Here at Bethelios, we will not let you down.
Oh, grazie. Grazie.
Alfredo, we cannot let 13,000 people down. This will make a difference.
Ciao.
So that's a lot of pasta. And we will not be open for business through the month of March. Don't come for your Italian eating delights here at Bethelios, but do bring pasta and pasta sauce. We're excited for Minnesota Food Share Month. I'm also excited to invite Mia Erickson to come on forward and to share a word about Thrivent Choice. Mia, good to have you here, and thanks for sharing a good word about ways that we can be involved in ministry together.
Hello. My name is Mia Erickson, and I'm a Bethel member and a Thrivent financial representative. I come to you today to talk to you about Choice Dollars. Choice Dollars are a part of Thrivent's charitable outreach funds that are member-directed to the church or charitable organization of your choice. And Bethel happens to be one of those choices and has been since 2010. So far in 2017, 57 Bethel members have directed $9,434 to Bethel, and that is awesome. But there are still choice dollars left out there that have yet to be directed. So if you have any questions about how to direct them or what choice dollars are, feel free to stop by and talk to me or contact me via email or phone. Over the past several years, Bethel has received almost $100,000 in choice dollar designations that have been directed by you. So that is very generous on your part, and we appreciate that. Another opportunity for giving is through Thrivent Action Teams. As a benefit Thrivent member, you receive two of those every year. So if there is a cause or organization that you are passionate about, apply for one of these $250 Visa gift cards as seed money to increase the impact of your event. If you know a family member or a friend who is a Thrivent member, reach out to them and say, hey, let's apply for one together and create an event. Now, I do realize that there may be different barriers to designating those choice dollars or applying for those action teams. So again, feel free to reach out to me and continue to live generously.
Thank you, Mia. We do appreciate the ways that we can work together in ministry, and thanks for the good word. We are called to worship now by our Bethel ringers. Thank you. I invite you to stand as you are able as we confess our sins and hear God's word of forgiveness. During the season of Lent, we are called to return to the Lord with all of our heart. So let us confess our sin and seek reconciliation with God and with our neighbors. Merciful God,
you sent Jesus Christ to save the lost. We confess that we have strayed from you and turned aside from your way. We fail in love, neglect justice, and ignore your truth. Have mercy on us and wash away our sin. Create in us clean hearts for the sake of Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
Behold, now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. Almighty God has mercy on you, forgives you all of your sin, and brings to you everlasting life. Amen. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, it is your glory always to have mercy. Bring back all who have erred and strayed from your ways. Lead them again to embrace in faith the truth of your word and to hold it fast through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. Thank you.
Reading from Genesis. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. And I will make my covenant between me and you and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham. For I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you throughout your generations, for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of people shall come from her. The word of the Lord.
Gospel according to St. Mark, the 8th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Then turning and looking at his disciples, Jesus rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to him, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Children are welcome for the children's word. Breakfast? Anybody hungry? Anybody want a bite? What is this? What? Flour, you're right. First choice. Want a bite? Big bite? Boy, that wouldn't taste very good, would it? What if I told you you could take this flour and you could make a delicious cake? Would that be better? Cinnamon roll dripping with caramel glaze. Would you like that? When you put all the ingredients together, you can come up with something really, really good. That's kind of what Jesus is saying, that he needs followers. And when you put all the followers together, we come up with something really, really good. Maybe you put together followers like you. And followers like them. And maybe all together those followers can come up with 1,500 pounds of pasta and sauce. And $5,000. Maybe you add ingredients like women farmers from Bihar. And you lift little kids out of hunger and allow them to live. There are lots of ingredients in our church. You're an important part of those ingredients. I think you're going to be challenged, too, to be a part of our Minnesota Food Share and help feed the hungry. Thanks for being an ingredient of Jesus today. Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. Many years ago on the ABC program Good Morning America, Charles Gibson was interviewing a jewelry designer when Madonna was very popular. The jewelry designer was marketing a line of crosses being promoted by Madonna. Predictably, the line of crosses was called the Madonna Cross. Among the many things that the jewelry designer said in the interview was, "Madonna has brought a new dimension to the cross. Never before has it been more popular to wear the cross." Charles Gibson challenged her by saying he understood that the cross was a symbol of Christianity. Oh, no, said the jewelry designer. The cross is a fashion statement today. No one wears a cross for religious reasons anymore. Gibson continued to challenge her, and she continued to say, "No, the cross is just the hot trend for today." An Anglican archbishop has said that the cross has become a thing of beauty, not a symbol of the deepest encounter and radical change for Christians. Evidently, that Anglican archbishop and the jewelry designer have not met a man named Jim Olson. Jim's funeral was held here at Bethel 9 days ago. A most faithful man. Among many other things, he and his wife Mary on Saturdays would set up communion for us for decades before ill health got in the way. You maybe bought meat from Jim behind the meat counter at Just Right Foods for 20 years or more. Jim had a habit of wearing a cross on the collar of his shirt. In the more than 20 years that I knew Jim, I saw that cross hundreds of times. But here is the rest of the story. Between the time of his death and the time of his funeral, I visited with his family and found out that if anybody commented on this cross in an unusual place on the collar of his shirt, he would take the cross off and give it to the person. Even if the person protested, he would insist that he or she take the cross and then would quote to them his favorite Bible verse, "I can do anything through Christ who strengthens me." The family thoughtfully made those crosses and cards available during his funeral. The cross is rather pretty, but it is not a fashion statement. It is a proclamation. In our gospel for today, Jesus tells his disciples that he must undergo great suffering and then die. Peter wants no part of this. But Jesus rebukes Peter and then calls together the crowd with his disciples and says to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." Take up the cross and follow. But in the same way that we have trivialized the cross into a beautiful little piece of jewelry, we have often demeaned this notion of taking up the cross, bearing the cross for Jesus. How many times have you heard or perhaps read people have said, "Oh, that's just my cross to bear." And it is often said of such inconsequential things. A woman named Jess Davis was addicted to her cell phone. It was never out of her hand until the first day of a vacation in Hawaii when her husband told her that he wanted to take that telephone. He said, "I really need you to be on vacation." She says that she handed it over with tears and with trembling, and it took 8 days before she was relieved of the stress of not having that phone in her hand constantly. She says that it became her mission to warn others of the same. She said, It was my cross to bear to tell others about the overuse of technology. Oh, wow. A cross to bear, a cell phone in your hand. A person doesn't like his or her hair. Oh, it's my cross to bear. A person has unruly children. Oh, it's my cross to bear. There's an unwelcome working environment. Oh, it's just my cross to bear. I tell you, people, Jesus is looking for more than a cell phone addiction, screaming children, and bad hair days. Jesus is looking for people who are willing to give their life, who are willing to lay down their life for the cross. And this is something that we take willingly on ourselves, not something foisted upon us. Take up your cross. It is a cross that is intended to change our life, not to be a minor inconvenience in our life. We are challenged to follow the model of Jesus, who was willing to give up everything for the cross. A lot of the world, especially our country, has been focused on Parkland, Florida in these past 2 weeks. Some stories have risen above others. A story of Aaron Feiss, a high school football coach who put himself in harm's way to shield students from oncoming bullets. A spokesperson for the football program has said, Aaron died in the same way he lived. He put himself second. He was a kind man. He died a hero. According to a 17-year-old junior, this coach ran toward the gunfire and shielded three girls from the bullets. He suffered a gunshot in the fray and lost his life in surgery. Aaron was willing to put his life on the line, to take up his cross, literally give his life for others. He could have saved himself, I imagine, but that was not his mission. His mission was to serve, and especially to serve students in whatever way was necessary. On the Thursday night after the incident, the football team gathered at Park Trail Park, where their Pine Trail Park, where there would be a memorial for all the victims of that massacre. The football team got there early. They hugged each other. They wrapped memorial flowers around trees, and they wore shirts that said, Faith, Family, Football. They remembered their fallen coach. Now, I don't know for sure whether this was a man of faith, although the shirts worn by the team would certainly indicate that, Faith, Family, Football. I can tell you for sure that this man lived out the biblical injunction to give up his life for those that he came to serve. He could have run away from the bullets. He could have secreted himself in a place where he would have been safe, perhaps even like an officer or more that chose not to go into the building in order to save the lives of students. But he did not. He served with his life. Statistically, it is almost zero that we will find ourselves in a similar situation. Statistically, it is almost zero that we will ever be in a place to push a person out of the way of a speeding truck. Unlike car chases in television shows, we will not be found on the top of cars or on the hood, frantically hanging on so we can catch the bad guys. Instead, our sacrifices are more likely to be modest, but no less faithful, that may be wearing a cross on a collar and then giving it away with a favorite Bible verse. It may be speaking up for those people who cannot speak for themselves. It may be denying ourselves some of our own desires in order to share what we have for others. It may be Billy Graham giving up a far more lucrative way of life, which he could have had, in favor of being faithful and preaching Christ. Taking up the cross is a choice that we make. Jesus does not promise that the road will be smooth. He does promise that it will be a meaningful life and with a glory at the end untold. Said Jesus to the crowd and his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it." Amen. Hymn 667, please rise and sing.
Let us join together in confessing our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, and the virgin Mary.
Let us pray with confidence through our Lord Jesus and in the power of his Spirit, ask his mercy for all need. Merciful Father, your salvation comes to those who hear your word. As you have gathered us together under Jesus and his cross, we ask that you bless the preaching of the gospel here and throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy. Kind and loving Lord, look with mercy upon this congregation. Strengthen all of our worshipers and families that we may be living witness to your promise of eternal life in our homes, at work, and at play. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, who comes for each of us, hear our prayers for all your children who are suffering or in need, the lonely and the afflicted, the grieving and the dying. We lift up to you those who are in need and those who care for them, including Karen Schaefer, Pastor Linda Helberg, Chris Rusted, Dan Wendelken, Tom Loglin, Mark Smith, and Marvel Betts. Comfort those with troubled hearts with the promises of your word. Surround them with your angels to protect them in body and soul and grant them a happy release from their afflictions according to your will. Lord, in your mercy. For all families who are mourning the loss of loved ones, Lord, we ask that you bring your healing balm, good friends, and time to reflect on the ways that you have provided through the lives of our loved ones. Be with Diane Willoughby and her family in their loss, and be with the family and friends of Sharon Wold. May they know your comfort these days. Lord, in your mercy. For our neighbors, our country, and our world, we ask your leading, protection, and peace. Grant wisdom to our leaders, courage, and safety for those called upon to protect the innocent, and fruitful dialogue and conversation for those looking to find better ways forward for the sake of our families and neighbors. May we work for peace as much as it is possible in this old world, so that others can clearly hear your good news too, and so that we can all find true peace in your death and resurrection. Lord, in your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for the new birth you bring to each one of us throughout the gift of forgiveness in Christ. Bless those who have recently been or will be baptized into this promise, including Ellie Jean. May she and her family be constantly held in your word. Lord, in your mercy. These prayers and those which remain on our hearts, we pray to you in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, and we offer them this day. Amen. Amen. We continue to give thanks for the opportunities to partner with Lutheran World Relief in Bihar, India. So during our collection of the offering, we will enjoy more pictures from recent travels to Bihar. You may be seated. Thank you. pray. Merciful God, receive the sacrifice of our prayer and thanksgiving and the offering of our lives, that following in the way of the cross, we may know the joy of the resurrection through Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
One final announcement. You may have heard in our prayers today that we included Pastor Linda Helberg. She did have some unexpected surgery this Friday, and she is resting comfortably in the hospital and does desire your prayers. Please, however, we kindly ask that you do not visit Pastor Linda at the hospital so that she can rest and heal. Receive this blessing. May God, who has called us forth from the dust of the earth and claimed us as children of the light, strengthen you on your journey into life renewed. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Marked with the cross of Christ, go forth to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.